What's up, you filthy casuals? Welcome to the Casual Shenanigans Gaming Podcast, a podcast all about the irreverent love of gaming. I'm one of your hosts, Jeremiah. Tonight, I'm joined by James.
What's up?
Joel.
Hey, friends.
And Dave.
Hey, guys.
All right, we start the podcast like we always do with the elephant in the room. Should we talk about Pokemon now or later?
It's Pokemon Go, Jeremiah.
It's Pokemans.
Oh, Pokemans, okay.
If you see Joel's feed turn off, he might have one near him.
So I'm not playing Pokemon. I've never played Pokemon with cards or otherwise. Dave, are you playing Pokemon Go?
No, it's just not my thing. I think it's a really cool
Dave,
phenomenon, but...
Is it because it uses data?
Well, that's part of it. that is 100% part of it. But no, I was that kid.
Using data isn't his thing, okay?
That's not my
Pokemon Go, as far as my Wi-Fi reaches.
Dave will check for Wi-Fi if we stop at a gas station for literally 5 minutes.
Everywhere I've ever been with Dave, he has the Wi-Fi password. I don't really know what type of black market connection he has, but like he has the Wi-Fi for Sweet Frog and the burger joint and the Mexican yep. place. And like I didn't even know they had Wi-Fi. Dave's like, oh yeah, they have Wi-Fi.
Joel, when we go to the Mexican restaurant to eat lunch... Every time I connect three stores down to the two bars of Staples guest Wi-Fi that's coming through like all the other stores, just so I can like my phone's constantly like syncing everything. I just prefer that to happen on someone else's plan.
You can tell but it no. not to sync stuff on.
Nope, I'm good.
Okay.
The reason I'm not into Pokemon though is because I was that kid as a child and preferred Digimon instead. So.
Oh, I didn't play any of the Japanese card-based battling games because they were all evil.
Well, it was a show. It wasn't a...
Oh.
I didn't really play any of them because I was in college.
Oh, just kidding. James,
not quite that old.
you have collectible figurines of like cartoon characters. I feel like that wouldn't have kept you from playing Pokemon if you wanted to.
And?
Did you play Pokemon? Back in the day. Oh, you didn't? Okay.
When did Pokemon even...
90s, I mean, right? Late 90s?
I think it was probably early 90s.
Like, 95.
Okay. I think it came 95, in right
95, 96-ish.
Right on the heels of Pogs.
That was high school.
I was huge into Pogs.
Oh, I'm sure.
Oh, my gosh.
And knowing you and your weird stories, you and your brothers made your own Pogs out of cardboard because you couldn't buy them. And
no, we got them. My mom, she would take us to Michael's craft store because they would have a huge bin. And I remember you could like take like 50 for like $5.
And they were organic.
Organic pods. No, but I could get like all the slammers, and I had one that had like crossbones on it, and I had a couple Star Wars related ones. Oh man, Pogs were awesome.
You almost got the mark there, Jeremiah. Joel's version of Pogs would have been like where if you use a slammer, like you actually have to slam someone in real life, like with a 2x4 or something. It has to have like some sort of horrible, violent twist to it.
And anyone who loses gets tied to something and thrown in the pool, and it's a team building exercise. Everyone stands on the sides and cheers while they try to untie themselves.
I try
you
it
guys
once.
Had very casual childhood.
All right. So, Joel, you are playing Pokemon Go.
I am. Yeah.
How are you liking it?
I don't really still understand exactly what it is. Right now, all I'm doing is just, like, I haven't really gone many places to collect much. They've just popped up around wherever I'm sitting. And so I've collected those. And then my buddy at work, he...
So everything's just around your couch?
Yeah, basically.
You wouldn't even go upstairs to play games with us.
But my friend at work, he was a huge fan of it when he was a kid, and so it's a huge nostalgia trip for him right now. And so, anyways, I'm kind of messing around with it. I'm dabbling in the dark arts, as you might say.
I wouldn't.
It's an interesting concept, I think. It's a really cool concept. Mm-hmm. And more of like, as my friend kind of put it, he's like, it's a weird phenomenon to see like all of your friends that you know playing it out in the middle of like a park that you just randomly stumbled upon. And everyone's talking about it, and it's just like an interesting. It honestly reminds me when it was at the hype of like the height of Lost hype. Mm-hmm. Basically, everyone was talking about it.
If only there was some way. Oh man, what if there were Lost clues scattered throughout real communities?
Oh gosh, don't even say that. That would have been ridiculous. Yeah,
find the real ending of the show.
If this would have been back then, that would have been insane. Yeah, but it honestly feels like that because everyone's all kind of talking about. It, they're all familiar. Everyone's been really nice so far. Yeah. So outside of the muggers and people falling off cliffs.
I think it's cool and it's positive that it's a game that people aren't embarrassed to say that they enjoy. Like, you know, mobile games have always kind of gotten a free pass of like, oh, you can play mobile games, but like, you're not one of those nerdy video gamers, right? Like, you just have a couple games on your phone. But a lot of people seem to be embarrassed, especially as adults, to admit that they really like gaming. They like being a gamer, and which is kind of silly because that's the main demographic of gamers are like men and women ages 18 to 35 or something. Isn't that it? So it's all of us. Older. It's most of us fit in that demographic. James, you're number two demographic. Number two.
A few more years, he'll be down to the third category in the demographics.
The gamer actuarial tables. So I think it's cool to have a pretty straight video game. Like, it's a lot more gamey than a lot of, you know, throwaway mobile games are. That people can play together. So it's like an online multiplayer game that people aren't embarrassed to go out and play together and meet new people and do cool stuff. Like, I think that's really cool that it's kind of a bit of a unifying thing, and it's something that, at least for the next week or two, lots of people seem to really enjoy. I'm almost tempted to download it and install it just for the community aspect of it. I don't know anything about Pokemon. I don't care anything about Pokemon, but I'm tempted.
Yeah, it's weird. I mean, I think I'm level 6 or whatever. I haven't fought anybody at a gym. I don't really know how to do that yet or anything. So I'm just kind of honestly just collecting them and seeing what happens. Like, there's like a list of ones you collect. I'm like, all right, that's cool. I mean, it kind of reminds me.
You're supposed to catch them all, if I understand.
I believe so. But I think it's, yeah. It's more of gotta catch them all.
Oh, okay.
Not just need to, but you gotta catch them all.
Sure.
Gotta catch all of them Pokemans. I still haven't, found a Squirtle yet, though. Everyone's saying that that's like an awesome Pokemon.
A Squirtle?
Yeah. Pokemon?
Yeah.
I think it is always Pokemon. Like, I don't think there's other connotations of the or conjugations of the word.
Really? I always thought it was Pokemon.
Really?
What do you think Pokemon stands for?
I don't know.
Pocket Monsters?
Oh! Well.
Well, there we go.
Digimon stands for Digital Monsters.
All right, nerd.
Nerd!
Mr. Homeschooler with his homeschooled Japanese
you,
battling card.
You are not one to talk, Jeremiah.
Yeah. Oh, I'm pretty
after
nerdy.
After you listed Battle Chess as your favorite fighting game, I never want to hear you call anybody else a nerd again.
When I was a kid, not allowed to play regular fighting games, if I pick it back up, it's Tekken 3, okay? I don't want to talk about it. Oh, also, we're joined tonight by Dave. Since apparently I missed giving you a shout out, you said in chat.
What?
Dave sounds like he missed a shout out. That was in chat.
No, he
like,
didn't.
Oh, wasn't
no, no, no. You did all the hosts. I had the chat in a different tab for a while and just got back to it like a few minutes ago.
Oh.
I'm saying I'm here.
Oh,
yeah.
I've accidentally given you two shout outs. Now that's kind of awkward. I've really helped
the
you
power,
out. More
so much
than
power.
You deserve. All right. So our main topic this evening is PSVR. It's not out yet. Duh. When it does come out, most everyone you know will not be able to buy one, even if they want to. But Joel and I drove to a not super local, but a somewhat local Best Buy. It's in our state. We drove to Best Buy and tried out PSVR. We went early in the day so that we could do as many of the demos as possible. And then we brought along a little point-and-shoot camera and filmed some of it for you guys and gave you some of our quick thoughts and our impressions of trying out this is like the retail spec hardware. The games aren't retail yet, but the retail spec hardware in kind of a ideal situation. So we've made a little video for that. That's going to be our main topic this evening. So hosts, go ahead and cue that up if you got it.
Cued.
All right, Dave, you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, and we will be back to talk more about it after this.
I'm going to be so poor come October.
All right, so where are we going? What's up, guys? We are going to a couple hours away. There's a Best Buy doing demos of PSVR. And do we know what games are going to be demoed or what gameplay experiences?
Everything I've seen so far is like a submarine type of underwater shark tank thing.
Okay.
Battle Zone, like a tank VR thing. And then
potentially London Heist, I think, but I'm not sure if that's only at GameStop or Best Buy. I'm not sure.
Okay, so Joel and I are going to drive and check that out and see if it's fun, see your kind of impressions of the units. These should be pretty close to production hardware, I believe, right?
Yeah.
So it should get a good idea of how it's going to feel. Now, obviously, there's not that many games that you can actually play for PSVR right now. Most of what's going to be coming out in the first couple months, at least, is going to be experiences where you just kind of see something cool. You go on a little trip, you go on a little journey within the game. So we're going to check some of those out and see what they're like and talk to you guys about it. All right, guys, we're here. And there aren't many people in the parking lot, so hopefully there's not going to be that long of a line. We're also here like right at noon, so... We'll see what happens.
We're riding five times.
Yeah, we'll see what happens when we get inside.
It's already in.
We plan on going through the line more than once, depending.
Oh, yeah, no problem, dude. This little button on the right, lower right-hand corner, too, that you can hold down and move it where my finger is down here.
Where? Right here, okay.
You can hold it down to move it closer or further away from your face. You want to try to get as little light in as possible.
Okay, that's pretty good.
Cool. It's clear?
Yep, right there.
So there's like a little click on the back that'll kind of tighten it down. So
okay, that feels good.
Yeah. And then here's some headphones that you can adjust for.
All right.
Familiar with the PS4 controller?
Yep.
All right, cool. So it'll have you where it says center. So just look straight forward and hold down the options button and it'll center you.
Okay.
And it'll kind of give you a tutorial to run and it'll kind of run you through how everything works.
Okay.
Yeah, basically all this stuff is like selection. Just hit X through all of it, and then it'll give you like a tutorial and then throw you out.
Okay, sounds good.
It's not blurry.
And so where's the little likes to adjust anything or
so
forward
or
backward?
So you need to like get it closer.
Okay,
like a
cool.
Button right down here on the bottom right.
Okay.
You just hold that in.
This right here?
Yeah, right there.
Okay, cool. Yeah.
And then for focus, you might have to like shift it around on your face.
Okay, no, yeah, I see it.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, I had the DK too, so wow.
Okay, cool. And I'll
wow.
Yeah, it doesn't have like a focus knob or anything because of the OLED screen,
yeah.
But
yeah, this is honestly a lot better than I was expecting too.
That's what a lot of people.
That's a good start.
And I imagine you're familiar with a PS4.
Yeah, I have a PS4. Cool. Yep.
Yeah, there you go.
So Joel, what do you think about the comfort of the headset itself?
Immediately from trying it on, it was honestly probably like twice as comfortable as the Oculus DK2 that I had. So it was there was a lot of people that were saying it was really, really comfortable, and I was really impressed. Like it was very comfortable immediate from like I after it was on, I was like, oh, is that it? Like, is there nothing else that I'm supposed to do? So that kind of surprised me. So that was a good surprise. It obviously we only got to try it for about 15 minutes each, you know, in one session. So it'd be interesting to see how it feels after, you know, 30 or 40 minutes, but so far, I mean, it felt really comfortable. Nothing on like my eyebrows or like just like on my cheeks and stuff. That's kind of where it kind of annoyed me beforehand. And I, you know, it seemed to get like my eyes would get warm. So
with the DK2?
Yeah, just because it rested there quite a bit. And I had to keep on like pulling the straps to get it tight on my head. So I'm curious to know if that same thing will happen again.
Yeah, with this, I felt like it was just like wearing a hat.
Yeah.
It wasn't bad at all. It was very, very comfortable on the top. Didn't feel like it was pinching the top of the head. Didn't feel like it was pinching my eyes. It didn't really feel like I was touching my eyes.
Pinching.
I mean, pinching the skin around my eyes. The only part that kind of felt uncomfortable a little bit was the flap of rubber that kind of seals your nose off from light. That was just kind of a weird sensation. Like it itched a little bit, just having the soft rubber collapsing in around my nose. But it wasn't, I didn't really think about it after I was wearing it for a minute or two, but that did kind of stand out to me when I initially put it on each time that like, that kind of feels weird.
It's funny. I'd be curious because I didn't have the same problem at all because I think I wear my sunglasses like all the time. And so I'm used to having something like on my nose. And so I'm curious, you know, now that you,
that could be it. I
wonder if you're just a little, you might be more aware of it. Like I didn't notice it.
Yeah.
Like it tickled for a second, but then I didn't notice it anymore. And I kind of forgot about it.
Another nice bit, the headphones, they were just using a regular pair of Sony studio headphones, nothing special.
Yeah.
They did not pinch around the headset or anything. It looked like there was plenty of room for them to clear the headset.
Yeah.
And it looked like there was probably enough room that I could wear my DT770s, which for me is kind of a big difference.
They're pretty big headphones, aren't they, too?
They are. Well, but the thing is, the overall size is not a lot bigger than my gaming headset, my G430s I use with my PlayStation, mm-hmm. since I can plug it into the PS4 controller. So those actually might be what I use more with PSVR, just because I have my DT770s sure. wired into the computer. But they have big ear cups as well, and it looked like there's probably enough room for them to clear without pinching anything, which that's kind of a big deal.
Yeah.
But it also looked like the strap could slide around your head a little bit, since you can tilt the glasses themselves up or down. But yeah, I would say there was no big issues with comfort. I don't think it's the type of thing I'd want to wear for 4 or 5 hours anyway.
Yeah, I don't think it'll ever be that case, most likely.
But comfort was overall good. What did you think about the screen quality?
This is very cool. Like, I'm really impressed with how quickly I can look around, and it doesn't have any like lag to it. Now, I know the DK2 wasn't final or anything like that, but like all the games that I played would have like rough spots in it a lot, and this is amazing.
The screen door effect was noticeable at first. Like, you could tell this was just like a film in front of your eyes, like you were looking through a thin piece of fabric, kind of.
Yeah.
Like, it's noticeable, but I think after a little while you just get used to it and then not really be bothered by it.
How does it feel looking around? Like, does it track pretty well?
Looking around looks really good. There's no perceptible lag when I'm looking around. Like, it doesn't feel like I'm looking through a video screen when I look around as far as the movement speed.
How does this one look compared to the other?
Since there's a bigger sense of scale, the stuff you're looking at, like I'm looking at space and ships in the distance, some of the stuff in the distance looks very pixelated. I'd say it looks PS2 era or early PS3 as far as the distance stuff. Stuff close up to you looks really good, though. Like, overall, it's not really detracting from the experience. I am getting a little bit more of the motion judder in this one. Even though the quality isn't quite what I wanted out of the screen, it was still immersive. It still kind of, it took me out of Best Buy. I told you, like, when I took the headset off, I was like, boom, I'm back in Best Buy, where for a couple minutes I wasn't. And I was actually surprised that it worked that well, given that the entire time I was aware of the fact that the screen didn't look incredible. Yeah, the couple times there were a frame rate drop, especially in the peripheral of my vision, it was very, very jarring, and I felt like a little bit of vertigo or motion, not sickness, but a little bit of like a motion effect when that happened.
Yeah.
So I think that is definitely something that's going to be important. And obviously they're stressing it because the graphical quality of the games they showed off wasn't very high. So it's obvious that frame rate is their most important thing to them. And after what happened, I would, you know, with a couple times it happened, I would say, yes, absolutely focus on the frame rate, because I got used to the low end graphics or the relatively low end graphics, and they didn't bother me that much after a while. But the couple times the frame rate dipped, that bothered me every time. And I think that if that was constantly happening while you were having like a 2 hour play session, it would probably be extremely uncomfortable.
Oh yeah. I mean, that is huge. That's key. One of the keynotes that Sony had, we're talking about saying that their games are like mandatory. It cannot have that problem. Like, that is like a no, because it's not just okay, I'll just get through it, but it can literally destroy the whole experience and like make you extremely sick. Because when I had the Oculus, when I had my sister over and she tried it, she had one bad experience, and that was like, she probably never try it out again. So that is absolutely key for all these, and I think even more so for Sony, because, you know, it's much more of, I think, a room friendly device of, oh, your grandma, pick it up and try it out, you know. Because I think people who are getting on PC are going to be more hardcore, that are going to be willing to try out settings and stuff like that, or maybe know a little bit more about what they're getting into. But I think for the casual users, it's got to be locked. So hopefully a lot of the games that come out are going to be, you know, not motion sick inducing.
Are you Starbucks right now?
Oh, that was a little nuts. All right.
That was a great reaction.
Oh, I'm going to hit stuff. The sense of space, I'm still trying to get a handle on here. Like, literal space.
Does the ship feel closer to you, like the cockpit?
Yes, very much so. No, it feels like I'm in the ship, definitely. Alright, I just got a little motion sickness right there. Okay.
Yep, I'm good.
Alright, so Joel, which one are you going to go play?
I think I'm going to do Eve Valkyrie, because I loved your reaction of it.
Okay.
So I want to... I'm a little nervous actually right now. Oh gosh. Whoa, shit. When Star Wars comes out, I'm gonna be lost.
Let's just see, I'm gonna... Oh, that's cool. I'll sit back in the safety seat.
Yeah, just in case.
Unfortunately, my kind of biggest gripe with VR this entire time has, for all the platforms, has been these like little demo experiences will probably be really cool, but I'm not going to probably buy into it myself until I can just play games. Like most of the games I want to play, or at least half of the games I want to play, I want them to be VR capable before it's worth the hundreds of dollars investment for me. But that said, I thought these games were really cool.
I've never been this deep in actual water. The first part, I've been that deep. I've never been this deep. Just kind of feels
now
weird.
Deeper.
Yes, the graphics were really low res, and some stuff was blurry on the peripheral of my vision, and there was a lot of like perceived chromatic aberration because I think the headset wasn't quite focused right. So like there was all these little things that weren't good, but like as soon as I launched down the tube, it was like, whoa, that's cool. And that yeah. was a kind of experience I've never really had before in a game.
Yeah, it is nuts because, you know, when people definitely talk about motion sickness for the game, it's not necessarily only graphics. They're thinking, oh, it's, you know, it's more because VR simulates feeling like you're in a ship. So imagine yourself an actual jet fighter doing flips and barrel rolls. You're probably going to get sick. It's not just that VR is that, but VR makes you feel like you're in there. So that's why it can be motion, you know, sickness. But I think it's one of those things that I think we're going to have to play a little bit, get used to it. And then I think you're just going to kind of adapt and you'll probably get used to it. Cause that's how I was really sick the first couple times playing with my DK2. And then after I played it for like a week or so, it didn't get me sick anymore. Like I knew what a barrel roll felt like, and my brain was like, all right, I'm not actually doing this.
Oh, I can see beneath me too. Okay, that's cool. I'm not super impressed with the thickness of the piping on my little deep sea cage here. I feel like if I was actually going down here,
you'd want a little more protection.
Does the shark feel huge?
I mean, he looks big, yeah. And it was like, I don't know, 15-foot shark.
Not quite Jaws.
Not quite.
Bruce.
I was a little bit bummed that we couldn't play anything with the actual PlayStation Move controllers, because one thing that does take away from the experience a little bit is like you're looking around in the tank, but like you can't reach out and touch any of the stuff in there. Like you can hold up the controller and see it in your hands, but I think it would be really cool if you could, like the PlayStation Move controller, each one of them corresponded to a hand. You could like reach towards things and get little vibrations in the controllers because you're touching them or something, which is what I hear happens in the Batman demo and the London Heist demo and everything that wasn't available there to play at Best Buy. So I was a little bit bummed because like that, I would really like to experience that. I feel like that's like a crucial step, is having those little motion controllers. And that's what everybody who's tried a Vive and an Oculus says, is that's the big difference between them, is the motion controllers. So I'm excited to try some PlayStation Move controllers with some actual games when it releases. But I thought overall the games, they were really just demos. They were to show off how cool this experience could be, but they were fun. You know, like I don't think it was worth, I wouldn't spend $400 just to play those demos over and over again.
Yeah.
Like there's definitely going to have to be
here,
more. Yeah. There's definitely going to have to be more games. But those games were really fun, and I think they did a pretty good job getting me excited about it. Cause none of those games were something I think I would spend a lot of time playing on my own, like the little tank battle game.
Same here.
Not that much, you know. The Eve Valkyrie, maybe if the game ends up being cool, but it was like an old, pretty simple version of Star Fox. Like there was nothing that special going on with the game. So, but overall, I thought the games were pretty fun, and I'm looking forward to trying out some more retail games, AAA games.
This is pretty cool, man.
This is one of my favorite demos.
Whoa! Okay, that's pretty cool. Do you see that on that, Jeremiah?
What's going on?
Can you see my controller on the screen?
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty cool. This is pretty cool that you have to actually look around.
I think the trip to be able to Best Buy to see the whole thing really gave me the idea that this is gonna work. Like it's a workable device. It's a Gen 1.
but I had a fun time. Like, even just looking at the helmet, I mean, the headset, the cables, how it hooks up, it just, it seemed very kind of slick and I think put together, and it didn't feel like a alpha project, I guess. It felt like, hey, here's a low budget entry level. You plug it in, you're going to have some fun playing some VR games. And that's what I'm excited about, because I'm investing in this. Because I want to invest in Gen 2, you know, because I'm excited for this version, but I'm also excited for VR to get past this and go into Generation 2, which hopefully this will succeed and keep going. But everything seemed to just kind of work really well. And I was really impressed by how well it tracked your head. Like, that was amazing. There was the DK2, I don't know the latency on it and everything, but like moving your head out, you could feel a little bit behind. It wasn't much, but you could just barely tell. But this was pretty amazing, because I would flick my head around really fast and it tracked. And I thought that was really impressive for the camera that they sold with the PS4 almost 3 years ago. So I think I think that's pretty impressive, because they said they planned it for VR, but still, that's a long time to have a camera out that really hasn't been used for much outside of a few things.
Yeah, really, like, you know, if you bought a camera ahead of time, you kind of wasted your money unless you bought it for one specific game.
Yeah, like, but it came with my bundle, so I was like, whatever, but to still think that's a camera 3 years old that they're using to track, I thought that was impressive.
It is, and now I told you at the time, my big concern with that is that it tracks really, really well. I agree with you. That worked awesome. I am a little bit worried at having those, I think, was it 6 bright blue lights on your head in the a dark living room or something, especially for you. You really like playing in the living room with Joy sitting on the couch next to you. And I'm a little bit concerned, because blue lights are very annoying in dark rooms. That wavelength is pretty annoying to our eyes. So I want to see it in a dark room, because I'm a little bit worried that shaking your head around is going to be annoying to people around you, and it might be a slightly frustrating experience. Like, I'm legitimately worried that could be annoying.
No, once you're inside
the headset, it's much less. Yeah, you know,
you're flying like, kill all the bad guys. Everyone else is like, get that freaking thing off your head.
But any final thoughts, Joel? I mean, I think you kind of summed it up well just a minute ago. I definitely believe in the product. I didn't think it was going to be terrible when I went to go see it, but I was a little bit skeptical that I was going to be blown away by how cool it was. And it was definitely cool. Like, it's not cool that I want to run out and spend money on it right now, because I want to see what games are out that I can actually play that are full experiences.
Yeah.
But the product itself was very, very cool. And I would say I'm definitely a believer in the potential of VR now, having tried it.
I feel like your opinion's a little bit, definitely changed a little bit, not necessarily for games, because I don't think any of that's really ever going to convince you until you really play a legit game. And I'm not convinced of any of the games either. But I do like investing in some of this new tech. But I think just seeing that, hey, okay, you know, the cries of, oh, the PS4 is not going to have enough graphics to play a game. It's like, no, I don't think that is going to be the problem. I think it's going to be the whole system as a whole, that it all needs to work together. It all needs to have decent games. But then I think, yeah, it really does come down to the games. Can the games be just fun, exciting to keep you wanting to come back? I don't think the graphics or the connections or the controllers are going to be any of the problem now. I think it's going to be all on the game side.
Yep, I agree with you, because any of my issues with the console or with the quality of the headset, the quality of the screen, if the games are good, I'll work around any of those issues. Like, that wouldn't keep me from playing it. But I'd be more excited to see the Gen 2 that's like the resolution of the screen or something, because I definitely, long term, I don't want to play on a screen that looks like that. But short term, if the experiences are cool, I'm totally in. That would be cool. I'm fine with it.
That was awesome.
Yeah, you were in it, so you probably didn't hear me, but I was
I was in it.
I was like, this is the closest I'm going to get to piloting an X-Wing.
Captain Adamo's right there with me. Oh, man, I was just imagining Star Wars the whole time. Like, I saw X-Wings. Yeah, Star Wars is going to make a lot of money for me.
Like, they haven't already. Like, they have been making as much money as they can get from you.
Battlefront is going on still because of me. That was a blast. Hey, I still play jump back in line.
So one big glaring issue with the entire PSVR demo presentation, and I told Joel this, like, half the people in front of us, as soon as they take it off, they're like, wow, that's cool. Can we buy one? Well, no, all the pre-orders are gone. and there's no word on how many retail units are going to Best Buy. So Sony sold all of them, and then they started trying to show people how cool they were by letting them demo it. If they'd had like a pre-order thing where you could swipe your credit card right when you got out of that demo, they would have. They probably sell like a dozen a day at every. Wouldn't they, Joel? Like a dozen a day at every Best Buy.
Yeah, I bet so. Honestly,
Oh, it's such a come on, Sony. Like, get your act together. Get more pre-orders.
Yeah, it'd be awesome if they had one more surprise pre-order before.
That's what you're banking on. You're like, it'd be real awesome.
If not, I'll be out. I'll be out there really early, so I might enlist my brother to help me out too. So, I really want one.
When does the Star Wars VR experience come out?
I think late October.
Okay,
that's what I'm hearing.
So a couple weeks. We'll see. Oh, is there an actual confirmed date, or are you just clinging to the rumor mill desperately?
No. I thought I saw October. I couldn't say. I mean, maybe it is, but that's the last time I remember seeing it.
So. Okay, gotcha.
But there's a bunch of games that are coming out, and I'm excited for it. So
now I'm excited to try an Oculus or a Vive. I want to see them and compare them because. Graphically, I definitely don't think the VR is reaching to heights that like an average computer couldn't get to, but I kind of want to try a Vive. Maybe I'm wrong, but it seemed like they shot for a very manageable graphics level, and with a couple exceptions, they hit it during all those demos, so good on them. Dave or James, you guys have any thoughts or questions before we move on?
I don't think the problem is for me is going to be like you guys said, graphics. I think it's going to be quality content.
Well, that's my main concern, too.
And I don't want to play a bunch of 30-minute games or even longer games that are just, I can look around and shoot type things. I want to, have real game experiences, games that I'll be playing anyway, and add that, that extra depth like, Fallout is going to be doing with the Vive.
I agree.
Until Sony has some kind of killer app for it, it's not something that is a save up money and buy that over any other competitor.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think all of VR, it's going to come down to games. Will they create really awesome game experiences / good games that will make you want to be like, oh, I got to get that on VR, where I could just play that the 2D version or whatever. Something interesting is it's such a challenge, I think, to create VR content because it is so different. I was watching earlier today some guy talking about his impressions of playing Fallout VR.
Mm-hmm.
And something I never thought about, I bet you guys haven't thought about either, is it's more than just, oh, let's port it over to VR, right? Think about shotguns and games, right? So let's say you have a PlayStation Move, or you have two controllers, or the Vive, you have these two little controllers. How do you usually hold a shotgun in a game? You see two hands.
You hold it like this.
Yeah, with a controller. But like in VR, it works really great for a pistol. But then he said it felt so weird doing a shotgun using one hand. And then it was weird to use two Move controllers like separate that are not connected, because that was really hard to control because they move away. And it like, how do you do that, right? And so in the game for Fallout 4, at least the demo they had, the shotgun was just a one-arm thing. And he said it was just really weird to use it. And so I just never thought about that challenge in itself.
I don't think that's a problem because I've seen Jeremiah shoot a shotgun with one hand like a badass. So I'm just going to say.
But the one game I think sounds pretty promising is Farpoint. I was reading a little bit more today. It's about a 5 to 6 hour game.
Hmm. Okay, good. Because during E3, we had no indication of like, is this a demo or is this a real game or what?
Yeah, same here. So they said they're trying to get to about, I think, Call of Duty length type of single player game. But because they're moving to have to play with whatever that new PlayStation Move like controller. It's a two handed thing. And my guess, just after watching the Fallout video, so I don't know this is true, but it would make sense that that controller, all the rifles you get in that game are going to be rifles or two handed objects or things like that. And I think I'm like, oh yeah, I didn't even think about that. You know, there's a lot of games that, like how it looks on screen, you got to adapt it, where now instead of holding two hands, even though you're holding one hand, it looks weird. It completely changes. And I think, Jeremiah knows even more.
They could work with that though, if they really wanted to.
Oh no.
I mean, it would take nothing to put one hand in front of the other and have to hold it like this. And
it's a little bit more complicated than that. Like, it's hard to explain until you start playing a game why some things feel really good and then immediately start feeling really weird. Like,
well, I think of like something like stupid. Sports Champions, where you had to have the two Move remotes and pull one back to aim and then let go.
Yeah. Well, it's, I mean, yeah, again, so I mean, like, you have the shotgun is attached to one controller, maybe not the other, you know, but then it has to detect when you put one close together to aim. Yeah. Anyways, I think there's just a lot of challenges, and I think it's going to be exciting to see as the years go on, games that are 100% developed specifically for VR in mind. Those are going to be the really cool experiences.
I agree. I mean, it's kind of one of those things. We don't know how it all shakes out yet, but I'm excited to try as much VR stuff as I can to kind of see where it's going to go. But, you know, like I said in the video, I definitely wasn't a VR hater or anything, but I came away from this much more of a VR believer than I would have thought I would. Just that one moment of me launching down the tube in Eve Valkyrie, the graphics weren't that great. Like, there was lots of fuzzy stuff, lots of pixelation. There wasn't a whole lot to do in that game other than cruise around space, but man, when it shot me out the tube, that was cool. Like, that's something that I've never felt that way.
We know you thought that.
All right. Oh, by the way, Joel, his name is Commander Adama and then Admiral Adama. You call him Captain Adama again. I'll beat your ass.
Yeah, that was bugging me too.
It's because I was secretly thinking about Star Wars.
He's Lee Adama.
My bad. It's been a long time since I've seen it.
Well, you need to fix that. It's
as
now
far
time.
As my opinions of
Dave, your mic is muted.
Yow, ow, is it still muted? Wow,
Dave,
that explains why I haven't been able to interject for like the last 15 minutes.
You had nothing to say.
So have you been trying to? You're like, oh, they're just talking over me.
Yes, I've been patiently waiting my turn. So Jeremiah, you're gonna want to go to my mic feed and definitely cut out like the 9 times I tried to add on something. But then you guys just ignored
like, there's a lot of you quietly just going bastards.
It's a lot
but
of
I
mumbling.
Think,
a lot of that.
Go ahead, Dave. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, Joel's Oculus sold me on the concept of VR. I agree with you guys that it's the content that's gonna matter. And for me personally, I'm not sure how much of like the games that I play that I would actually play on VR. I think it'd be a hard break for me to like let go of the high resolution screens and the high graphics and play in VR over my traditional setup. I don't see it being a purchase for me anytime in the near future, but you better believe I'll be over, you know, mooching off of you guys' setups.
How about as a 3D artist? Would something like VR be helpful?
Not if it decreases resolution, because like already trying to work on 1440p or back at work now, just 1080p screens, it's not enough space to work. I could really use a 4K screen for the screen real estate. So yeah, I don't see VR as being super useful for 3D stuff, because right now 3D programs have algorithms that interpret your mouse movements on a 2D screen into the 3D environment, and adding a 3D way of looking into your workspace on top of that would feel like it would guess incorrectly way too much. Because working in 3D, like, you'll align something or extrude an object and like rotate the camera, and you're like, well, that went like 100 meters in the wrong direction, but it looked right from that angle. I think adding looking at that space in VR would add extra complication on top of that. But I could be 100% wrong. I'm just thinking about some of the current problems with working in 3D on a 2D screen. I don't think they would be immediately solved by working in a 3D environment with your set.
Dave,
I think something important. Oh, go ahead.
The way I thought about it, Dave, was like, I even said, I think this got cut from the video, but like, I would never want to play The Witcher on this. I know you would never want to play The Witcher on this. Like, there's some games that are just not a good fit for it. You want the maximum graphical fidelity. I think I would play most racing games on this, even though the fidelity is lower.
Yeah.
Because when the immersion, like when that happened, it was really good. And then I didn't really care that the graphics weren't as good, at least for a short play session. Like, I was very aware of the fact that the graphics weren't that great, but the immersion factor was so good that I like it didn't matter anymore. You know, the immersion kind of trumped that. And I know you love immersion, so I think it would depend on the game. So I don't know
It'd be tough sometimes.
Which games, like, okay, you play on a regular basis. I don't know which ones you play that you would prefer to play in VR, because you're not big into racing. Like, maybe Rocket League?
Maybe Stalker?
Well, here, Dave will never play a scary game through on his own ever, because he doesn't even play that on his 2D screen. I think honestly, something important to remember about
Dave,
VR
Dave,
is...
Dave was talking.
Oh, right.
No, I was going to return Jeremiah's point, but Joel, you go ahead and finish your thought first. It's all good. I've already been ignored for 20 minutes. I'm used to it.
Go ahead, I was going to say, I think it's important to remember that when going on VR, you're never going to have a higher resolution experience than what you could have on just regular 2D monitor.
And that would
bother me. As of now, right now, of course.
I mean, you know? If you stick to a PS4, you know, that's not true because they're going to get high resolution screens and it'll still be running at 1080p on games. But if you're a PC gamer and you're used to like 4K, then yeah, that's probably true. Sorry.
I just mean like you're not going to find a better graphical experience there. But what you will find is probably a better 3D experience. You know what I mean?
So, yeah.
Again, like if there was a Witcher 3 Gwent sitting down in a tavern, you would love the crap out of that because that's an experience you cannot have on your PC right now. You just simply cannot. It will not be as immersive as sitting actually in a tavern in Witcher. That's the experience it can give.
If you had to choose between playing the Gwent card game where like you've got the board up in front of you like it is in the regular Witcher game, or one where you walk into the tavern and just sit down and pull out your deck, I feel like I feel like even if it's lower resolution, like Dave, your immersion would like, nope, this fits. Immersion correct. I'm good.
You're both 100% right for The Witcher. I couldn't handle exploring even in VR at low res for like maybe more than like a little bit. But for stuff like Gwent or
in
interiors,
Witcher, just in Witcher though, but there are other games
just in Witcher.
Like Ethan Carter or Everybody's Gone to the Rapture or Firewatch.
All I'm saying is I wouldn't jump to conclusions so soon where you go, oh, it's graphics. There's a huge difference of, yeah, you have lower graphics, but you're in the world now. You're not looking at it on a 2D screen in your office. You're in it. So that's something
appeals
to me. I'm not saying to always play a VR game. I'm not always going to want to play a VR game over a 2D game, but I'm saying when you dive and have that first experience of like a 3D like platforming game too, like I would love to play The Witcher. Even the way it is right now, just to see how big the mountains are and stuff, because it's totally different. I mean, it's totally different. A 2D screen on a screen, it's kind of a big mountain. In VR, you're like, holy shit, that's like Mount Everest. That's what's pretty cool about it. So, you know, as time goes on, yeah, I can't wait to have 4K VR screens. But
Joel.
Yeah.
What? Sweet, sweet, innocent Joel. You so greatly underestimate my capability for immersion on a 2D screen.
I know, Dave. I can't even imagine what it's going to be in VR. Like, you're lost. You're gone forever.
Putting The Witcher aside, though, I think there are definitely games where a great one is Alien Isolation. That game looked beautiful on a 2D screen. Like, that came out of nowhere. It looks amazing. But I'd probably choose even a lower res VR screen whenever I go back to play it again, because that was like a next level experience. So I'd really have to think carefully for me personally about what I'd be playing on it. I think it would really vary like every different game that I play. And one other area I was thinking of too, a game like Battlefield where I get really competitive in Battlefield. I'm pretty good at the Battlefield series. Could I handle playing that in VR and being at a competitive disadvantage in multiplayer just for the immersion? And I don't think in that case I would play that in VR at all.
I don't think the competitive part would even be a difference. Like, you'd be moving so fast and you're running and gunning. I think it would make you sick. I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because I snap move in the Battlefield series. That's true. I get really sick.
It'll be interesting to see how you guys, think of it, when I get it eventually, of course. Because I mean, like, the motion sickness is real, and it's more the fact that you are in a tank, you're in a car driving that fast. It was really funny because I was talking with Jeremiah right before we started, just his expectations and stuff. And he said, oh, I don't get motion sickness or anything in cars and stuff. And I was like, I think you might get a little, you'll understand what I mean as soon as you try it. And as soon as he's in the ship, he's like, whoa, a little bit, because it really does.
That was also when the frame rate dropped was when it did the big difference. When the frame rate was stable.
You did a couple barrel rolls and I saw your face, but I'm just saying, like, you have, if you're not used to that at all, like if you've never done anything like that before, don't expect, it's not just a video game. You are now in the game. So that's like, it's hard to describe until you've done it. So.
Yeah.
So I can't wait for, like, I don't see Dave ever being a VR kind of person. Like, oh, I want to do that, because you do get way too immersed in games. And I can't even imagine, never play any of the scary mystery games because you just hype the crap out of yourself and escape it really fast.
I just take a small dose of horse tranquilizer and then just very sleepily play through it. It's fine. It's all good. I wanted to ask too, Joel, Had you talked about the design of the PSVR before being like, you know, it can't be lots of cables, it can't be super nerdy looking. You've mentioned all that before, haven't you? I think.
Yeah.
I'll say they definitely seem to have the cable under control, but man, that is one of the nerdiest things I have ever seen. It looks like you were from like a cyborg movie from a few years ago or something.
I think in 15 years it's going to look pretty dated. I think like definitely the one thing like the Oculus and the Vive have going for them is they're black. They'll just kind of blend in. Like they look ugly too, but it's less in your face. And the PlayStation
disappear
one,
into the past.
I kind of hope they come out with a black PSVR. That would be kind of nice.
With I have a feeling LEDs. They're going to come out with little face plates, I bet, for it.
That'd be, oh, yeah, that would make sense. But with the blue lights and the white plastic.
With real eyes on the front.
Googly eyes.
It looks like a Star Wars prop, is what it looks like.
And not the good Star Wars, the early 2000s Star Wars. It looks like a Phantom Menace prop.
Did they use props back then? I thought it was all in the computer.
It is now time for the news.
News time.
Transitioning far away from VR, Joel, what's going on with PS4 VR games and controllers?
My first thing, it's been officially announced that all PSVR games will have support for the main controllers that it comes with the system. So it's been rumored, people are wondering if that is the case, like, do I have to get the moves? Is that something that's bundled with it? And anyways, it's just been officially, you know, announced that that's the case. And I think that's interesting. I think it's a good and slightly maybe a bad thing, because I think, you know, having the Move controllers is going to be probably a really cool experience for games, and I think it's going to enhance quite a lot of them. But there's also going to be a lot of games that you don't need those. A controller will be better. But in a way, in one small way, that is getting the price a little bit lower, because you essentially do not have to get $50 more of Move controllers or whatever. I think they're like $35 or $40, I guess. They're probably going to go up now because everyone's going to buy them. But anyways, I just thought that was interesting. I just saw that it was.
I think that could be a negative thing.
I think it will be. I mean, all the demos we played, none of them had the PS Move controllers even offered as an option. Only the London Heist one does right now. Not that the final games will, but like, I think if they want people to buy Move controllers, they need to be pushing them the whole time along with it. Like, we should have been able to try them out in store. I think it's almost
absolutely
dumb. Yeah, I think it's...
But, I mean, the same thing. I mean, the Oculus has no controllers right now.
Oh, I know, either, and that's so, the I big mean, negative. You know
what I mean? And it doesn't even have a trackable controller. And when, so at least the PlayStation 4
controller
is trackable.
But that's the benefit of the Vive,
trackable.
Is that it
so.
Has controllers that
and the reviewers
are going to actually make you
the
feel
Oculus and the Vive say the biggest difference is the motion controllers make all the difference in the world. So that's why I'm saying I think it's a mistake on Sony's part. Yeah, it's great that it can support the DualShock 4 in all the games. I think that's great. But I think it's a mistake to not push the Move controllers as hard as they can. Because
Sony's
that's the
already
reason
got that they've already got the technology.
Yeah, the reason Move never took off because Sony didn't push it. They put it out. They put out a couple games. It didn't blow up. They stopped pushing it. They didn't support it that much, and then nobody cared.
It was also on the decline of that even being interested. Not that what didn't support it only.
Oh yeah,
but
definitely.
People were not getting interested. That was like the tail end of.
But
the
I'm saying
Wii
that's kind of that's Sony's Move though. If something doesn't blow up and becomes Move, if it doesn't blow up and become super popular, they've got a bad track record of going oh well. And moving on to the next thing, and if they want the motion controllers to be popular, they need to push them really hard. And so far, I don't really get that
feeling. I don't think they have to be to have,
but they should have
great games.
They should
Why?
Be, though.
Why?
Because it makes the experience so much more
you
accurate.
You don't know that yet. I mean, like, you don't know that yet.
Yeah, Joel, you'll knock the Oculus all day for not offering motion controllers.
I'm not knocking it.
And then you'll say,
knocking,
but it's okay that the PlayStation one doesn't because DualShock's better. And
I'm not knocking it.
Having
I'm
used
just,
the Move controllers.
You make it sound like it's not like, oh, this is a totally new thing. PlayStation's not having it. I'm like, no, I think you're going to be able to have better experiences for some games. But you have to realize the Move controllers are not going to be for every Vive game, for not every single Vive game is not going to be a standing move around. I will guarantee that that VR in the future is not going to be a massive thing because you're going to have a giant room you can constantly move around and play VR in. That's not going to be the thing that's constantly sell the games. That's going to be an amazing experience, but something you want to do just regularly, just like the Wiimotes were. No one got up and played golf anymore. They sat down on their fat butts and they would just swing the Wii remote. So I'm thinking I think you need to have good experiences sitting down
you
consistently.
You can sit down with the motion
and then there's extra
yeah,
ones.
I mean,
yeah.
But that's been everybody's complaint so far. That's even you, when you had your Oculus Rift, you say, I look down and want to see my hands.
Yeah.
They're not there.
I'm still saying the
this, I mean, this
controller still is trackable. You could see it in the game. So that was still
Like, that's, at least they have something.
Yeah, but you're looking down your hands like this.
What?
Hey.
No, you can see them in the game.
Right, but with the move, it's one-to-one, yeah, and the camera's tracking it, so literally anything you do with your hands, it could track.
Yeah,
and I'm just, yeah, to me, that is the next step for it actually feeling completely immersive.
I think the hardest part is the locomotion thing, because when you have the moves, you don't have a joystick to move forward. You're going to have to lean or something like
they
that.
They have no, a navigation controller.
Not if you have two move controllers. You have to have the two little orb ones. That's the little sub one that doesn't have the move track one on it. So we'll see, I think.
All right, what's going on with Battlefront?
Offline mode's coming out in like just a week or two. So you can now play offline and play like with the whatever your friend in split screen, and you can just do an actual like kind of like original Battlefront 1 and 2 where you could just kind of do AI bots. So they're basically, that's cool. At least they're adding that in. I think it's, you know, it's, I don't think it's not too late. It would have been awesome if it came out right at the start. But honestly, I mean, like, I know people complain about that stuff, but I think people who are into these kind of games generally probably have internet. So, I mean, I think for a smaller amount of people that have it, that don't have it, would like to have it. And it's glad that they at least made it eventually.
Yeah, it does seem a little bit like a why now thing, because it's been like 8 months.
Yeah. But hopefully that'll be in Battlefront 2 as well, or whatever.
From day one would be nice. I don't like the feeling of having to wait like 6 or 8 months after a game comes out for it to be done, you know? Like, that's happened with so many recent releases. I mean, even The Witcher 3 got a completely overhauled UI a year after launch. Like, I know lots of developers do stuff like that, and it keeps people coming back to the games, and they want to keep improving the games. They want to keep making them better after launch. I understand that. But it does kind of suck to feel like I want to buy the game and play it, but I don't want to feel like I'm missing out on experience I'll get for the same price later if I just didn't play it now, you know?
Yeah.
But Valve has released a statement about last week's topic about Counter-Strike Go gambling.
Because of us.
Yes. And it sounds like they're doing pretty much what this podcast recommended. No one else was really saying this. It was really just us saying this. So they seem to be taking our advice. They said, in 2011... we added a feature to Steam that enabled users to trade in-game items as a way to make it easier for people to get the items they wanted in games featuring in-game economies. Since then, a number of gambling sites started leveraging the Steam trading system, and there's been some false assumptions about our involvement with these sites. We'd like to clarify that we have no business relationships with any of these sites, we have never received any revenue from them, and Steam does not have a system for turning in-game items into real-world currency. Small break there. That is technically true, but Valve does take a cut of any of those items that make their way back, and people do trade them with other people or sell them on Steam again later. Valve does get a cut of that, and Valve is kind of creating these items that can be sold and resold within their economy. Even if some of the sales aren't legitimate and they're due to gambling and Valve doesn't get cuts of those sales, they will still get cuts of any legitimate sales that come of that item after the fact. And they can definitely turn that into real world money. So let's not. So anyway, what they said is technically right, but keep it in mind. Then they go on to say, these sites have basically pieced together their operations in a two-part fashion. First, they are using the OpenID API as a way for users to prove ownership of their Steam accounts and items. Any other information they obtain about a user's Steam account is either manually disclosed by the user or obtained from the user's Steam community profile when the user has chosen to make their profile public. Second, they create automated Steam accounts that make the same web calls as individual Steam users. Using the OpenID API and making the same web calls as Steam users to run a gambling business is not allowed by our API nor our user agreements. We are going to start sending notices to these sites requesting they cease operations through Steam and further pursue the matter as necessary. Users should probably consider this information as they manage their in-game item inventory and trade activity.
Mm.
Which is as close to a veiled threat as I think we're going to get.
Watch your step.
Users should keep this in mind while they consider which items they want to do what with where. But, I mean, it's weird. It took like a week and a half for them to say anything. But, yeah, I mean, that's a step in the right direction. And it's Valve doing damage control and trying to distance themselves from the whole thing. But
did you really just say something about them taking a week and a half to say something? I mean, it's taken them 10 years to come out with Half-Life 3.
So. Well, that's true.
A week and a half, that's pretty good.
New records. Like light, that's like now. That's like instant.
Do you guys have any thoughts on that?
I mean, it took too long, I think, but at least it's happening.
In other CSGO gambling news, both T-Martin and Syndicate are back to making normal videos with no mention of anything else going on. So I'm guessing their legal teams are saying they are not allowed to say anything in public anymore, which would make sense. But man, the dislike ratios on their videos, their recent ones, are pretty awesome.
Oh, I forgot to mention. Do you know what? Did you see their update for Rocket League that's coming out? Rocket League is getting unlockable crates.
Yeah.
But I know, like, okay, I immediately was like, oh, son of a bitch. But they're offering literally an option to completely remove all of that. You will not see any of it.
That's kind of an interesting way of going about it. Like, guys, here's this cool new thing. New like revenue stream for us, but if you don't like it, turn it off. That's cool of them.
Yeah, what they say is crates will contain cosmetic content only. We will have a strict don't sell advantage policy for Rocket League, and we're sticking with that. There will be no Steam Marketplace integration with crates. We are definitely aware of the problems related to third-party gambling, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Players who don't want to interact with the system can hide it entirely with a single checkbox. Also of note, this won't affect or impact our current item drop system in any way.
All right.
My only thought on that is if you literally can just delete it and it's not changing at all the way their drops, man, go the high route. Yeah. Just I don't know. Stay cool.
Stay cool.
I don't know. I mean, it's just kind of like, I don't know. It's dumb.
You think it's dumb, but there's probably millions of fans who really enjoy that stuff. And if it doesn't affect the way they actually play the game, if it's just cosmetic stuff, it is one of those why not things. Millions of fans want it.
Then I make a call out to any of our podcast listeners. Oh boy. Who really wants this? Who loves this stuff? Like, oh, cannot wait to get those unlockable crates.
Let's be reasonable.
I'm just curious.
Who at least mildly enjoys them? Okay, you don't have to be a super fan. You can just mildly enjoy it. That's okay.
I'm
saying more of love, because the people who just mildly like it, I think would be like, it doesn't matter. Take it out. We don't need it. But I think it's the people who, as you're saying, that love this, apparently, I feel like, no, go the higher, just, I don't know.
Leave a comment.
I'd be curious. Please.
Leave a comment or write into casualshenanigans@gmail.com and let us know if you like it and or love it. And we will make a special rule. Joel cannot crap on you when we read them out. All he can do is sit there and go,
I just don't understand that. Like, I mean,
welcome to being old, Joel. Yeah. You get your blind old man rage. Like, I still understand kids these days. Why do they like the crates and the unlockable?
He won't crap on you, but he will shake his fist at the sky and go, you!
You know, I get angry because when I grew up, you just got it all for free. You just, you earned it in a game. Like, you played for, you paid cash in digital money, you know, by killing people in a game and then unlocking a cool, you know,
right,
Navy SEAL suit or something like that. But now it's pay $2.99 for it.
Or unlock it using in-game currency.
Yeah, I know, but it's just like,
okay, that's fine.
Just don't.
Okay, all right.
Earn loyalty, people.
Joel, you're so disappointed.
I am disappointed.
Oh, that's amazing. Joel.
I've been around for a while now.
When this happens, we need to use our non-journalistic functions to make sure there's no trading going on. I think we need to stay on top of this story. Wait. For Rocket League. See if people find a way to do trading outside of.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely, Steam. Absolutely.
I wanted to ask.
James and I both start one underground trading league. We're all against it. We're like,
yeah, I just wanted to try
millions.
That. Man, what a rush!
Rocket James League and Joel. Gambling.org.
Not James and Joel's Glotto.com.
Way to publicly distance yourself from it, Joel.
Whoops. I wanted to ask Joel, what if next week Battlefront added crates of like unlockables to the game?
It's not to the level of like hearing the word vapes or ripping a ripping a sick cloud.
Hey Joel.
No. That is fingernails on a chalkboard, like,
this is amazing.
What if Dark Souls added crates?
Don't!
See, Joel,
oh, my favorite game!
Joel, this is the problem. Like, you definitely should not start a gambling site because you signed up for a spam email address to troll us with and use your real name. So I feel like you would be swatted within like 10 minutes.
Totally not Joel at gmail.com.
You're too honest of a person. Like, you don't belong in this world. Get out.
be the world's longest URL. Joel, the director of Norman's CSGO gambling site.com.
Come on. I know Dave would be utterly crushed if CD Projekt Red just added unlockable chests and crates under like a paywall, or you have like unrealistic XP level in game that you have to get like to get.
Oh, I'd turn something. It off if it was an option for sure. Yeah.
No, there is no option. Let's just say it just is there. Like that would ruin everything for you. I think you're like, what? Like I have to now unlock the quests by doing.
We already talked about this guy. If like he gets to a town, it's like you can visit this town for $5.99.
Just go, why CD Projekt Red? You were the chosen ones. Why?
I loved you. Why?
Will you pay $1.99 to complete this quest?
I mean, Dave already knows with Star Wars and Gwent, if there was physical Gwent cards like Pokemon cards, yes, I would be buying them. And I know it's so stupid, but I would be buying them. Right. But that's what I'm saying.
Joel,
I'm pleading.
If you can write
please
into
casualshenanigans@gmail.com
and explain why you'd be buying these things and explain your love for it so we can read it on the podcast next week because you don't understand why people like this stuff.
Oh, man.
I don't want it to happen. I'm just saying I would have to do it because it's Star Wars. I'm not saying I love it. I'm saying it's more if I have to.
I know it's different, buddy. It's different. You have to because it's Star Wars. I understand.
It's just like I have to because it's Geralt.
Don't shake your head at us. This is your twisted logic we're exploring. All right, let's move on. No, we're done. We're done, Joe. I've given you your 10 minutes of screaming.
Okay, all right.
Incoherently
done.
At the screen this week. Get your 90 seconds ready. James.
It's all ready.
James, what is going on with Nintendo this week? Something actually happened with Nintendo this week, James.
So I'll start out with the thing we already talked about, which is Pokemon has caused their stocks to shoot up quite a bit. Although they've started to drop down, like level out a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's definitely been a success so far. Even Joel is hooked now, I think. Going to the fire station at 10 o'clock at night. I mean, that's just creepy, Joel. But the thing that they released today that, honestly, it came out of nowhere. I mean, it's always made sense for them to do this. They're releasing a miniature NES, which has 30 built-in digital games, does not connect to the internet, you can't download anything or add cartridges or anything. But it comes with 30 games, kind of like the Atari Flashback or any of the other various ones like ColecoVision. Sega had a crappier version of it. It looks amazing. It's $60 and it uses the standard Nintendo size controller. For me, the thing that was the most surprising is the list of games that it comes with. Usually when you see these collections, it's like they've got, you know, like Atari has like Asteroid, Missile Command, and then it's got like 20 other really just crappy games. Like, I've never heard of that game. But looking through this list, they have Castlevania 1 and 2, the Donkey Kong games, Double Dragon 2, Dr. Mario, Excitebike, Final Fantasy. I mean, so they're getting third-party games in their Ghosts and Goblins, skip down, Kirby, Mega Man 2, Metroid, Ninja Gaiden, Super Mario 1, 2, and 3, Super Contra, Tecmo Bowl, Legend of Zelda, and Zelda 2, and nice. A few other games.
I've never played Zelda 2.
So to me, as someone who's owned a Nintendo, it's a really impressive collection. I mean, there's always that list of games that, you know, you wish they, you know, put this in there, but it's better than I would ever expect Nintendo to put out in a collection. And the controllers you can use, if you have a classic controller, you can hook it into the system. It uses the same port as the Wii controller uses on the bottom. You can also use the controller that comes with the system for your virtual console for the Wii U, which is pretty cool. And the extra controller is like $10. So it's pretty affordable.
Now, I feel like that would have been an awesome thing to announce at E3.
One more thing. What type of video outputs is this going to have?
HDMI.
Okay. It comes with an HDMI cable too, and it's powered by USB.
Okay.
So I think you just plug a USB.
I was curious about that. I mean, as cool as it would be, John and I were joking around earlier, as cool as it would be to have just composite cables or like a coax out or something, I assume they would have to have HDMI. Now, are games going to still run 4:3 though?
I imagine they will.
Are they going to be upscaled?
I mean, that's like any collection you buy.
Yeah.
Like I have the Mega Man collection for Xbox One, and it's 4:3, and you can either turn on or turn off the side crap. Now, I don't know if they're going to do like certain collections where you can actually use stretching and smoothing. I don't know if Nintendo will go there, but even at 4:3, I think it'll just work.
Cool. And Dave. It's a
day James. One buy for me, I think.
I
think I'll pre-order. I honestly think it's going to sell out really fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like
$60 for
where they haven't really planned how many they're going to sell. It sounds like one of the things that's going to be very hard to get because Nintendo's just not prepared for it.
Because I think even if they were prepared, it's so cheap for that many games.
They could sell just a collection on a disc that had those games in it for $60 and it would sell like crazy. So selling a miniature like collectible NES console is like a slam dunk.
I mean, have you seen pictures of it?
Yeah.
It like literally just fits in the palm of your hand. But it mm-hmm. looks like the little NES console. I think it's fantastic. I think.
Yeah, because remember how I mentioned like it'd be cool if they made small ones? Because I think I sent it to my friend Ben and he's like, I am absolutely going to buy this for my kids.
And what does Ben have now for video games?
Nothing.
Okay. So yeah, I think there's going to be a lot of nostalgic buying for people who aren't even gamers anymore.
I love that it comes with a controller with a cable too. Like, I just think that's going to be really cool. And the fact that it is small, has HDMI where it's not going to be a problem to connect it to your TV. You know, I think that's going to make it even easier to like, hey, let's play classic Mario or play Tetris or, you know, I guess whatever the games they have and stuff. I'm really excited. I hope they do a Super NES and N64 too. That would be cool.
All right, Dave. There's an NVIDIA technology. It's not a new technology, but it's being implemented into a game. I think this is the first time it's ever been implemented in a game. What's going on? What new NVIDIA GameWorks do we have to look forward to?
Oh, man. What has GameWorks got for us this week? How else can NVIDIA sink their claws into their customers and try to keep them around? NVIDIA Ansel, which is their screenshot creation tool, has finally launched with its first game. A weird choice, because they demoed this in, it was early May, right? Late April, early May, when they announced the new cards?
I think so, yeah.
Demoed it in The Witcher 3, which already has a huge screenshot gathering community. I mean, there's like Flickr accounts out there with just some amazing stuff, like Birdue level screenshots. But the first game has come out today, and it's Mirror's Edge Catalyst, which most people forgot launched about a month ago. It launched with zero fanfare, but it's the first game that supports Anvil. Ansel. It's Ansel. Initial reviews are positive, but it appears to have a couple of issues. Some people can't hook the screenshot creation tool into the game. There's some issues with doing the custom resolution scaling, which is one of the most, I guess, exciting parts about this screenshot tool is most of the time, if you want a really high res, 10K screenshot, which looks amazing downsampled, you have to force your graphics card to render like 1 or 2 FPS, like a window with your game running at that actual resolution and try to line it up with just a corner of the game on your screen to get your shot. Well, with Ansel, you can actually set up your shot and it'll pause the game engine and render out a tiled super large version, which is what people want for good quality screenshots. And apparently some people are having issues getting that fixture to work at all. But it does have the ability to do super high-res screenshots for those who can get it to work. It can do 360-degree VR screenshots. It can do free camera, filters, all the usual stuff. So hopefully it comes out for other games very soon, because I want to give it a go in The Witcher. Surprise, surprise.
All right. It is now time for 90 Seconds with Joel, a part of the podcast where Joel talks about whatever he wants for 90 seconds.
Okay, I'll try to keep this kind of brief. It's a little bit more serious, but in a playful way. Kind of.
All right, so now
it involves.
Is this actually serious?
Yeah. It will actually. This is what I was gonna do a couple weeks ago, okay. But we kind of ran out of time. It actually comes around to Star Wars, and it has to do with funerals.
Setup. What is this?
I'm sorry. I know. I'm just lightening the mood. Okay.
Really?
Anyways. Okay. Yeah, I am. Okay. So, a friend of our family's recently passed away a couple weeks ago. We had a funeral at our church, and anyways, it was a great funeral. I mean, like, it was some really awesome speeches, and you know, learning about anyways, friends from our homeschool group and stuff. And anyways, I just wanted to make a challenge for people, you know, who listen to the podcast. And I'll show you why I mean connecting back to Star Wars. But it really kind of drove home, you know, just really spending time with family and making sure you say the things you wanted to say to them, good, you know, or bad, maybe just to get it out there, get it out there in the open to, you know, to, you know, move through it or something like that. And thinking back on Star Wars, The Force Awakens, those are the kind of movies. I mean, like, I want to have my experience, right? Like, I want to be able to sit there, enjoy every second of it. The best sound, just, I don't want to be bothered. Like, I want to be in the moment and enjoy it. Right. My mom had begged me to go with me for months and months. Right. And honestly, my family is generally like, my parents are not the best people to go, I think, see a movie with all the time. Cause my mom can be very loud and kind of be obnoxious. And like, it can sometimes ruin the movie going mood. Okay. But it was one of those things that I remember. It was after, because there was some other stuff that happened even before that, but this kind of just really rang home for me. But it was like, you know what? I was like, you know, I want my mom to be there with me with Star Wars because she really wanted to see it. She's a Star Wars fan because I'm a Star Wars fan. She yeah. doesn't really follow yeah. any of it. Like, she will do anything for me, basically. But I had a really fun time. And just, she waited out in line with us, and like, she loved every second. I even got my dad to somehow show up too, because he was not wanting to go, but he came too. But we had an awesome night, and I just remember thinking that night, like, yeah, this is not the best experience to watch Star Wars, in a way, like, if visually, maybe audibly, because she's, you know, poking in, and she's so excited, and she's like, "Are you enjoying this, Joel?" Like, halfway through the movie, and I'm just like, "Everyone, could you not?" As Dave says,
"I'm having special yeah. Joel time with the Force."
It is yeah, pretty much. But it was a special moment for me. Like I had to go, you know what? I don't know how long my parents I will have with them on Earth. And so it was a special thing to be able to say, you know what? And for as long as they can come see Star Wars movie with me, they're always going to be invited. And I wanted to be able to experience with that, because it was such a treasured moment for me. And just being at the funeral and hearing some of the speeches, and I was like, man, I need to do something nice. And so I like had to spend time with my mom, and I called her and everything. And so I just urge people here, you know, if, you know, call your parents, call your mom, call your dad, do something special for them, surprise them, make them a lunch, bring them a dinner, do something, go play putt-putt or whatever the heck you have in your town. That's fun. Surprise them, spend a little bit of money, use up some of your free time that you maybe don't want to use, do it anyways, you know, even if it's not the most fun, like, cause it's going to mean a lot to them. And I know it meant a lot to my mom, and I was just like, man, I need to do extra effort. You know, like, it was just like, I need to not waste time, and just like, cause they can be frustrating, and everyone has the parents that can be, you know, over loving or annoying or not great to bring along. But I just say, go do it, urge you to do it. So that's your challenge for this week and for the rest of the weeks. But let me know if you're able, you have an idea, you know, don't make up one, cause I'll know it's BS, but be nice, but you know,
write some treasure sappy
friends
story.
And family.
Uncle Joel will know if you're
yeah,
lying.
Yeah, Uncle Noah.
What did that please you so much, Joel?
I was thinking of Game of Thrones. And yeah. So anyways, just,
Don't take any family cues from Game of Thrones. Don't do any of that stuff.
I do anything for family.
No, season one, when Eddard starts going to like chop the head off of the like traitor.
Okay, the
first
very
episode,
beginning
like,
to the show. Yeah, the very, the one yeah, yeah. time.
Don't close someone, your eyes. Yeah. Father will know. Yes.
Gotcha. Okay.
So anyways, right. I don't know. It was one of those weeks, and it was just kind of like a big reminder, and that, you know, video games are awesome, and you can also have amazing connections with friends and families like that. But just go do something in the real world. Go help someone. Go do whatever, even if it's a little bit suffering on your own side, because it's going to make a huge, huge difference and could make a huge difference in your own life.
I've said for that's a long, long time that like the real reason I still play Age of Empires, I never play on my own, really, other than the one Sunday where Joel, Joy, and John all talk some shit and needed to be beaten down. But I wish I'd recorded that. Oh,
never going to live that down.
Yeah, but no. Because me and my brothers always played it growing up. We always played, like, we had one computer, so we just traded off playing it and stuff. And now that one's in the military, one just graduated from college and got married, and, like, it realistically, we aren't all three together. I mean, maybe it'll be once or twice a year, you know? It just doesn't happen. But we can all hop online and play Age of Empires together and still hang out, and that's, like, the only thing we can really do remotely all together that we enjoy. And then the last time we were all together visiting down where one of my brothers lives, we took a picture of all of us sitting on the floor playing Nightfire on with GameCube controllers, our old GameCube controllers using their Wii, because that was kind of our jam back in the day, was Nightfire and Agent Under Fire. And we just took a picture, just, you know, oh, hey, Mom, look, we're playing Nightfire. And apparently, like, my mom cried. Like, she saw it, and it meant so much to her. but it was nice. It was kind of nice around her, like, oh, yeah, you know, that's, again, that's one of the things we like about video games. We said over and over again is at least half the time I'm playing games is to hang out with you guys, because if we can't hang out in person, it's about quality time to me just as much as it's about having an experience doing something else. And so I think it's cool if you're able to go. I agree with Joel, if you're able to go see your family in person, you should definitely do that. You guys know what we're talking about. Like, if you've got family members that aren't a positive influence in your life, you know that, and that's your decision to make. But for the family that you love and you cherish and you like to be around, spend as much time with them as you can, for sure. And on that cheery note, we actually have no mail this week, but if you want to be a part of the show,
no mail,
you can write into casualshenanigans@gmail.com to be a part of the show. And if you listen to this audio podcast and you would like to see Joel and I make dumb faces, go watch the video version of the main topic. That'll also be a breakout video on our Facebook page and on the Casual Shenanigans YouTube channel if you want to go watch it just by itself. But thank you, everybody, for coming out. If you want to hook up with us somewhere else, you can tweet at Casual Shenanica. You can also send podcast mail to the Twitter, in case you didn't know. You can visit our website, casualshenanigans.com, where you can download the Magic Castle of the Lost Knight, the game that Joel made, which is not charted on the NPD charts quite yet, but, you know, we're assuming it's going to any week now, but at least well over 100 of you have played it so far, so thank you to everybody who has
experienced it.
I've experienced it, played it, whatever.
Already experienced you.
We have a Snapchat. You can add Casual Shenaniga on Snapchat to answer Merc and Oil's question in chat. Casual Shenanigan or Casual Shenanigans is too long. That's why we have Casual Shenaniga. We went back and forth on so many options, but we eventually just did Casual Shenaniga. For personal shout-outs...
You can type in Casual Shenanigans. It's just going to stop.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. You just type it in. I mean, it'll probably get you there. For personal shout-outs, we don't normally talk about our own videos that much on here, but I made a fun video that some people might enjoy. I took Dave's GTX 1080 and threw it in the potato masher just to see how well it would do. And most of the internet seems to be enjoying it. There are some people who don't seem to understand the difference between a fun joke video and a serious graphics card comparison. So I'd like to apologize to everybody that I did not include 99th percentile frame time graphs in my fun video. But if that doesn't bother you, you can go check it out. And it's kind of ridiculous, but it was a lot of fun to make. Dave, do you have anything personal on the old Dave channel you want to pimp out?
There's a very special Battlefield 1 video coming probably in the next couple days.
So by the time this is released for everybody else on YouTube, it's probably out already. Go to Dave's channel. Yep. Channel URLs are in the description. And I think we've got us tagged on the main Casual Shenanigans YouTube channel. We've got us in the sidebar. We're boxed. Box for box. But thank you, everybody, for coming out. Thank you for subscribing. Thank you for being part of the show. If you haven't yet, go and rate us on iTunes, because it makes more people look at the show. We appreciate that. You can, of course, always support us on Patreon. It keeps the lights on and lets us get these dope-ass mics. So thank you, everybody, for coming out. We appreciate you all. We'll see you next week. And until then, stay casual.